Hey guys, I'm the 50s kid. This is my E46 BMW and it's leaking oil. This time it's the oil pan gasket, so I'm gonna change that in this video. The only special tool you need is one of these. It's an engine support brace. It supports the engine from above because you can't support the engine from below, you know, with your jack. Normally when you're jacking the engine up from below, you're jacking it up by the oil pan, but of course we need to get the oil pan off, so can't do that. You need to support it from above. You can get one of these at Harbor Freight for about 68 bucks with the 20% off coupon. I like it just fine. It works well. It does its job. So, you know, it was a good buy for me. You need this tool in order to do this job. I haven't found anywhere that you can rent it from. So take that into consideration. Other than that, it's pretty straightforward. So let's get started. So I've removed a couple of things while my oil's been draining before we get started. The air scoop, the air box, the upper intake boot, the fan and the fan shroud, and both accessory belts. If you don't know how to remove these things, check out my E46 common repair steps video. I'll put a link to it right here. So we're gonna need to remove the power steering pump off the engine because it's gonna be in the way when we try to get a couple of the oil pan bolts off. So we're just gonna remove it and we're gonna kind of wire it up and out of the way. And there are three bolts. There are two on top, one here, and one behind it here. And then there's one that we'll get at from the bottom of the engine. So these two on the top are 13s. I think there's gunk on this bolt. That's just preventing it from pulling out. So there's that bottom bolt. It's sort of at a diagonal. And I'm expecting the pump to fall after I take this fully off, but it doesn't really have far to go. So we've got to get this lower splash plate off. It's held on with 8 16-millimeter bolts. I'll leave this one for last. So now I'm gonna roll my floor jack in and I just wanna take up some tension on the engine on the bottom of the oil pan there. And I wanna raise the engine up just a little bit. Probably about that much. As you can see, I've got the engine support bar in place. I've got it hooked into the engine lifting point right there. And the reason I lifted the engine up is because you're never gonna be able to actually get this tight enough such that when you do drop the K-member and the engine drops down, to prevent the engine from actually moving down a couple of inches. You know, it just, you can't get it tight enough with your hands. So a little trick I use is to lift the engine up a little bit, get the support as tight as you can. In this case, we don't need to go too tight because there aren't chains. It's especially worse when you have chains because those chains, they do stretch, but there are no chains involved here. So it's just going to kind of tense up and it's going to pull itself down. And so, yeah, that's the reason I lift up the engine. And so now when I let the engine go, you can see that it just kind of, all the weight gets placed onto the engine support brace. And now we can feel free to lower the engine support member and continue on with the job. Next, we're gonna disconnect the lower control arm bushing. It's 2 16s. Don't worry about this messing up your alignment. As you see, there are two collars right there, so this fits on and there's no adjustability there. Here's the passenger side. We need to disconnect the steering column from the steering cubo, whatever the hell, however you pronounce it. And it's an E12, right? E10. It's an E10 Torx, external Torx socket. I
I had to put my key in the number one position to just unlock the steering column, and then I turned the steering column a little bit so that this bolt is just facing down like this, and I'll just leave it there while we're doing the job. That way things don't get out of position, and I just kind of want to pull it out a little bit. There's not enough clearance to get it out right now, but as this drops down, it'll be able to drop free of the steering column. So, all right, we need to remove the engine mount bolts. This is the driver's side. It's a 16. You might want to hit these with some penetrating fluid and use a breaker bar if you're doing it manually. And here's the right side, passenger side. So now we need to take off the sway bar bushing mounts. They're 13 millimeters. Careful, make sure that bar doesn't fall on your head.
Okay, what you see right here is actually the level sensor. It lets the headlights move up and down as the wheels move up and down. And the thing is, this is actually it's actually bolted to the K-member, the engine support brace. And so it's gonna drop down with the K-member, but this wire is not gonna drop down. It's zip tied to right here. So we want to disconnect it. And I believe if you just push on the bottom of it, it should come off. Although mine looks really dirty. Ah, both sides. We need to push on it on the top and bottom. There. So it's you just push on the top and bottom of it and it will come off.
I've got my floor jack under the car and I'm just going to take up weight on the bottom of the engine support member, the K member, right there. Then I'll unbolt it on either side. That way I can lower it down safely.
Alrighty, this is the right side, passenger side. It's an 18, there are two of them. And left side, driver's side.
Alrighty, that should be enough to drop the subframe. Let's lower the jack now. Hold on, we're a little off. Let's keep going.
Probably a good idea to use a bigger piece of wood as well. Looks like it's a little higher up on the other side. Let me go check out what's keeping it higher over here. Looks like it's just the line that's coming out of the power steering rack. There's a little sort of a zip tie holding this cable up there, and I just kind of undid it. Yeah, so there we go. That's letting us come down a lot further. So now there's really good access to the pan. We have enough clearance to pull it out.
Need to take off this bracket right here so I have room to move the power steering hose. The 10.
So this was the power steering line here. There's a zip tie here you can see, and there's one here. This is the one that I released in order to let the hose down. The hose was actually running up here and running along here and going down. So I undid that and it allowed the post to just fall down, and that's how we got the whole thing to drop further down. We also need to remove the oil dipstick tube. I believe it's a 13. Yes. There we go. All right, so I just had to remove all those other things from the common repair steps video, the lower intake boot, the disc valve, the heat shield, things like that. It's all in that video, the upper
microfilter housing tray. It's all in that video, so you know how to do it because you've already seen it, I'm sure. Now I can pull the dipstick tube out of here and need to get that CCV return tube off of it first, though. Okay. Yeah, if we just pull it up, it should be a little easier to get that lower, that oil return hose off of it. You know what? On second thought, I'm just going to leave it like that, because why does it need to come out? It can just stay right where it is, and we'll put it back once we're done. Okay, so one issue we have is that these are bolted to the oil pan. Right there, that's the bolt that we need to get out. It's a 13. This the feed hose that goes down to the power steering pump is in the way, but okay, there we go. So I'm gonna start removing the oil pan bolts. They're all 10s, and I'll count them. Once I'm done, it's going to be difficult to get a shot of each and every one of these, but just so I can help you visualize, they're running along the bottom edge of the oil pan here, around the side. The pump is, of course, in the way, and they come up and around along the top edge. Okay, hopefully this is a good enough angle for you guys for the rest of this. I'm going to disconnect the oil level sensor. Yeah, that's working. I can feel it. Goody. Okay, let's get the rest of the bolts out. Ooh, really long one in the back. Another really long one. So there are just a couple more along this side. And it looks to me like this bolt and this bolt right here go into the oil pan here. You can see it just goes through into there and one into there. So I think I need to remove both of those. They look like they're probably E10s or E12s. So they're actually E10s. There is one more Torx bolt that's running through the transmission into the oil pan right here. So I've actually got a little bit of an extension on my ratchet so that I can get some clearance for the head of the ratchet. Okay. And the other two that I missed are actually up through here. Okay, sort of a medium length bolt. Cool, look at that. Pan's already loose, wants to drop. Really, it's just the power steering pump that's in the way. have to go to the front to just get that stuff out of the way. Also looks like the ATF cooler hoses, those are sort of binding things up. There we go. So these are the bolts that I ended up taking out of the pan. There are 21 little bolts. There are two medium ones, two long ones, and three e-torx ones. So I've been cleaning up the pan a little bit. It's pretty gunky. I kind of knew this. The person or persons who owned this vehicle before me really probably didn't change their oil often enough. But anyway, I'm gonna hit this thing with my pressure washer, both inside and out, try to get it as clean as possible. I also probably should go and get some engine degreaser to dissolve a lot of this. But I think I'm gonna end here for the day because I have to get to my regular job, but we'll pick it up tomorrow and finish it up. Voila, nice and clean. Well, not perfectly clean, but hey, how clean does the inside really need to be, you know what I mean? The outside though, I think it's nice and new and clean. Look at that. It doesn't even look like the same pan. Very cool. I also want to show you the gasket. Now here's the old gasket, and look along the inside. This is the material that actually seals, and it's supposed to be rubber, but as you can see, it's hard. It's a little pliable in some places. It's cracking. It's pliable in some places, but it's cracking in others. There you go. Crack, crack. That's old. The rubber gets hard just like all the gaskets do. This one is the new one. It's nice and rubber and pliable and nice and good. So brand new gasket we're going to put on. Let's get it on the car.
By the way, make sure you take the O-ring out of the dipstick tube hole and put it on the dipstick tube.
Alrighty, this is the front of the engine, and you need to put some RTV where the front cover joins the rest of the engine block right there, those two lines. So I'm gonna put some red RTV on those. Thin little strip. Just like that. Okay, things are kind of in the way, kind of hard to get the camera in there, but basically it's again, you know, you can see where the seam is, where the block joins the, in this case, the transmission. And you just put some along there. And then along the other side. Alrighty, this is gonna be challenging. Mostly challenging because we gotta keep the gasket in place. And you know, some kind of a gasket dressing might actually be useful in this case. Mostly to just stick the gasket onto the pan and keep it there. But all I have to do really is make sure it doesn't slide completely off. And then I'll just be able to slide it into the proper place. And the only tricky part of this is getting it past the transmission cooler tubes. By the way, I did inspect the nut on the oil pump on the front of the engine there, and it was fine. I'm not gonna do anything to it. Oops. I believe the problems with that were mostly on the E36. E34 or E36? I think it was the E34. The first 3 series. Let's see now. Or no, wait. I believe that was the second 3 series, right? First one was the E30? Who knows? Okay, I think what I'm going to do is go to the front of the car right now and pull this past where it needs to go, because working from behind there is just not working for me. I think just like that. I struggled and I prayed and I managed to do it. Now if we Oh, bummer. Aha. Yes, there we go. And that did the trick. Now, let's not smush the RTV. So you gotta get your pan basically up into place, sort of where it needs to go. Just need a couple of threads to get started. Hopefully that'll do it. Let's put this side one in. Get that started, a couple of threads. Yeah, I think it is. Just pop the gasket, align it on the front there. Okay, I believe that is good. If you're wondering if I'm gonna use my impact to do this, you bet. Of course, I'm not gonna run them down hard. I'm just using it to run them down. See, till I hear it make some noise. All right, now I'll just start the rest of them by hand because I've got the gasket aligned. I can see it aligned on the front and I know it's aligned on the back. And don't worry, I will be torquing these as best I can. So I will attempt to torque these. The torque is 7 foot-pounds. 7 foot-pounds, honestly, is so little that, you know, it's doubtful that any torque wrench you would have would even be calibrated for that. Like, for instance, I've got one that goes from 10 to 100 or something like that. And torque wrenches are usually most accurate in the middle of their range anyway. Honestly, the one I have from Harbor Freight, it goes from 5 to 70 or something like that. And I have used it before to do 7 foot-pounds, and it doesn't seem to hurt anything. But the thing about torque is, especially when it's this low, the whole idea is not to over-tighten these bolts, okay? So don't go crazy. If you don't have a torque wrench, it's okay. You can hand-tighten them. Don't go crazy with it. Just tighten them really slowly until you feel that they're tight. You know, if you keep going any further, you know, you don't want to go that extra quarter turn that's going to snap them off, okay? You just want to make them tight. And I've been making them tight, and they've pretty much been 7 foot-pounds. I haven't actually been tightening all of these. These ones I left a little bit loose. See, and it was just like another quarter turn because I didn't really tighten them. So that one was, again, another quarter turn. I'm not gonna be able to do all of these with this. It's just too awkward. There's stuff in the way. It'd be so nice to get these automatic transmission cooler pipes out of the way, but that's just not possible for me. So if you've got a manual transmission, it's a lot easier for you. See, that one was there already. This one I left loose. Ooh, somebody didn't tighten this at all. There we go. all good. Make sure our torx setting doesn't come loose. This thing should be locked, is what it should be. There we go. Okay, front half good. Those are already done. Yeah, that one's done. Looks like I've just got one, two, three, four along the side up here. Just need some extra long extensions to get up to these bolts over here. By the way, earlier I had taken these pipes and I had kind of wired them back a little. I actually unwired my power steering pump and moved the wire to here, and I just kind of wrapped it on this stud back here. And that was working for a while, but then the wire kind of came loose and I don't want to put it back on right now. But that was definitely helping. And that one I already got. Okay, so that is all of the pan bolts. Now I just have to do these three e-torx bolts and we're good. I am not exactly sure what the torque is on this one. The torque specs in the book are the names for them are kind of vague, but I'm gonna go with 16. I'm hoping that's the right one. Yeah, that seems right. 16. And I don't really think I'm gonna be able to get up on that one. Always try. I don't think there's enough of a swing. Yeah, this shield is just in the way. But that's all right. I'm pretty sure that I got 16 on that one anyway. All right, I do feel it's important to point out that you've got a couple of targets of opportunity here that you can change while you're at this job. Number one would be the engine mounts. I mean, they're pretty easy to get at. They're right here, you know? I do recommend getting a swivel socket and untightening the bolts from the top. It's just easier that way. Take a look at my engine mount video to see how to do that. Here is the steering guibo, whatever, of steering flex disc. This rubber deteriorates, so this is an excellent time to replace this. I've already done mine, of course. And then you've got the lower control arm carrier bushings right here. These are definitely another target of opportunity. Okay. Need to reconnect the oil level sensor here. Wow, look how clean and pretty. So we gotta get this bracket back into place. As you can see, I've kind of broken this part of my bracket a little bit while I was moving these lines out of the way and such. I really don't care. I think it'll probably be fine. If it's not, find a replacement somewhere, but you should do what I said and just wire these back out of the way. That way they won't be such a problem to you, or as much of a problem to you as they were to me. Well, mine's totally trashed, so there's probably not much point in putting it back up, but I'm gonna do it anyway. Well, kids, we have reached a magical moment in the night. Time to put the subframe back up. That should be pretty challenging. So what I'm doing is I'm just looking for, first of all, the four bolts that hold the subframe up. You know, they go through a certain area, and there's I'm looking at where
where they screw into the unibody. I'm also looking at the engine mounts, making sure those six bolts basically go up to where they're supposed to be. And right now I can feel a little resistance, and I think what this is the engine mount. And I'm guessing that the whole engine itself has shifted over to the right a little bit, just based on I can feel where the engine mount bolt is, and it's a little bit towards the driver's side. But the engine's actually just kind of mobile there. I was able to slip it through. I can actually push the engine with my hand, and it's sort of, it is hanging up in the air by one spot, and it's just sort of swinging. You know, it's easy to kind of swing it back and forth. So I was able to get the one engine mount stud through the hole. It's just almost there. There. Here we go. So I just pushed both of the studs, the lower studs on the engine mounts, through their proper holes. And I can see that I'm aligned up right up here. I'm aligned with where, you know, the hole's gonna be. On the front, it just kind of goes up into place, but in the back, there was like it's like a cone shape. So there's a cone that fits up into a little slot, and that'll just kind of help to kind of center things. So I'm good there. I'm gonna double check over here. Light would be good, but I think we're good. Don't need the jack anymore. Come on, let go. I think I will also just push the sway bar back up into place and just start the nuts onto the studs. That way it's just out of my way. I want to torque these to 81 foot-pounds. Make sure you plug this sensor back in. Not sure what the torque is on these. Just get them tight. Okay, so we have remembered not to move anything. Not to move the steering wheel at all. So now it's still aligned. And oh boy. Did I need to do this before I put everything back up? Probably. I think what that means is A, I'm a dumbass. B, I need to get the lower bolts off the Guibo, because I don't want to lower everything at this point. So if I'm gonna turn it, clockwise, a quarter turn, I'm gonna remember to turn it back there, like that. All right, I'm going to turn it another quarter turn clockwise. So I can pry on it a little better. Okay. That was harder than it needed to be. So I will stick a screwdriver through there and just kind of pry it open a little bit. That way it goes back on easily. A little bit of penetrating fluid on the spines inside here, inside this thing. Let's make sure that it slides on. Okay. I think that's about as good as we can get it. So now, the problem is we need to turn this thing back the direction it was. So since I had turned it clockwise two quarters or one half, I'm gonna go counterclockwise. Here's one quarter so I can get at the bolt, right? And then another quarter, and that's how it was, right? So that's the direction that I'm going to put this back on, and that's the way it goes up in there. And now it has the ability to slide further up on that shaft than it needs to be, and that's why I can get it on now. And we're not through the hole yet. You see, we've got another half an inch to go. This thing has to be forced down. Okay, that was a hammer and a pry bar. I believe the torque on these is like 18 foot-pounds, but who cares? Turn it that way. Cool, 18 foot-pounds exactly. I think it's gonna be easier to put the engine mount nuts on before you put the control arms back up onto the body. Just kind of move the control arm to where you need it so you can get in there at the proper angle. And the torque on these is 33 foot-pounds. If we can get these started. So I just kind of muscled them back in and got the bolts started. The torque is 44 foot-pounds. Okay, I really don't want to bugger up these threads. The engine support brace back on here. And these also get torqued to 44 foot-pounds. Put the oil dipstick tube back in. I've remembered to put the O-ring back on it. Tighten this thing up so that it stays where it's supposed to now. That really needed to happen badly. Remember to get this one pretty tight because this bolt tends to rattle off. So down here, this was the power steering fluid tube that I sort of unzip tied. Not really a zip tie, it's just kind of a clip kind of thing. Okay, this holds the heater coolant tube, and my little thing is broken. Yours probably will be too. If not, you know, you just pull it off right there. It's a little tab. So obviously I've removed the engine support brace. That doesn't need to be here anymore. Remember, the long one goes all the way on the end here. It's important to be able to find the hole. Haha. Medium one goes in the back here. It's gonna take forever. Let's see if we can get that in by hand first. I don't know the torque. I'm just making them tight. If you're reusing your oil the way I am, it's a good idea to go get one of these paint filters. You can get these at auto paint stores for free. Helps you to filter out any of those little particles that might fall into the oil while it's sitting out.
All done. Little crummies in there.
Glad I did that.
It's a good idea to check the oil, because if you're doing this job, you've been leaking oil, right? So it hasn't been very long since my last oil change. So I'm still full, which is good. Okay, so as far as putting everything else back together, that's all covered in my common repair steps video. So I'm not gonna film that now. I'm just gonna do all that so I can get it done faster. And we'll come right back and wrap this thing up. All right, so it's all done, all put back together, and I just warmed it up, brought it back up to temperature, and there are no leaks. So that's a job well done. I'm happy about that. Definitely the hardest part of this job was just getting the oil pan back up into place with the new gasket. If I had some gasket dressing material, which is something you spray on the gasket to just kind of help it stick to the oil pan, that would have been really nice. So that's one recommendation I have for you. Also, I just now read the instructions for doing this in the Bentley manual, and apparently, you know, if you have an automatic transmission, the ATF cooler lines that run alongside the oil pan there, I unbolted the bracket that's connected to the oil pan in the front, but there's also a second bracket that's attached to the transmission. If you unbolted both of those, the lines would have easily swung out of the way, and so I wouldn't have had so much trouble with them. So I definitely suggest you do that if you have an automatic. Anyway, thanks for watching.